Hello, so it's session 17. We are going to speak on, we are going to continue speaking on infinite products and Weierstrass elementary factors. So I think the best title is to write infinite products part 3. In the previous session, we had arrived to the conclusion that if you take any holomorphic, any entire function, it always can be written like this, as a power Zm times an exponential of some function times some infinite product. Where Zn are the zeros of the function f, provided that this sum, this series, converges. The practical problem would be to determine such a Pn and such a sequence Pn, and perhaps more difficult, the function h. We're going to work an example, do some example. The example is going to be the function sinus of z. The function sinus of z has a zero at the origin and has zeros at all the points k of k pi, with k, in fact, of k integral numbers. So, doing previous consideration, we could consider the function sinus of z divided by z. Sinus of z divided by z would be equal to the exponent, some exponential times some infinite product. Which infinite product? So let us study this function. Let us try to find some Pn, some sequence, some constant sequence Pn. For that, we need to study this sequence here. As p, as zn are kn, let's say, you can write zn as kn, well, the infinite and the positive and the negatives. Consider, for instance, the positive, the negatives is going to be the double, as is more or less symmetric. Let's say the zeros are symmetric. So you have to consider this series here. And this series converges when p plus 1 is strictly greater than 1. Okay, so we need p equal to 1. The smallest possible constant pn equal to p would be p equal to 1. So you could write, the series, the function sinus of z over z, we can write it as some exponential times some infinite product of E1, let's write like this, E1 of Z over Z of n pi, where we can take by n as any, let's say, any integral number different from zero. An integral number different from zero here. Okay, both positive and negative. Let us study a little bit this term, these terms. If you put together the term n and the term minus n, so you will have something like this, 1 minus z over n pi, exponential of z over n pi. This would be the term E1 applied to z over n pi times 1 plus z over n pi you would have that. So these terms cancel. You have this expression here. So the what you have here is the exponential of some function h of z times the infinite product of 1 minus z squared over n squared. So sinus of z over z can be written like this. For a certain function h of z. Now the second problem is the second problem would be to try to figure out which is this function here. For that, we're going to, well, sinus of z can be written as z times all this expression, and we could apply logarithmic derivative to this expression. Logarithmic derivative of sinus of z would be cosinus of z divided by sinus of z, so the cotangent of z. So if you apply logarithmic derivative, you would have cotangent of z equal to, you have a z here, it would be 1 over z. Remember that the logarithmic derivative of a product is the sum of the logarithmic derivatives, 1 over z, plus the logarithmic derivative of this term would be h prime of z, plus the logarithmic derivative of this last of the product by the theorem on infinite product of holomorphic function would be the sum of minus 2z n square pi square over 1 minus z square over. So this would be finally 1 over z plus h prime of z plus the following sum here, 2z divided by z square minus n square pi square. Logarithmic derivative would be that function, that sum here. We still have this problem, how to determine h of h prime. So in order to determine h prime, we are going to study this function here, the cotangent. And we are going to try to write cotangent as a sum, as an infinite sum. As an infinite sum. So this can be done in the following way. This is something that can be done in the following way. I will write a slightly different function, not exactly the cotangent for the moment, but it could be more or less the same at the end. At least, let us consider this function here. The function f of z equal to the cotangent. For simplicity of notation, I'm going to write the cotangent of pi z divided by, let's consider this function, z squared minus omega squared, where omega is some complex number, some non-integer complex number, in fact. Okay, so omega take some non-integer complex number, fix some integer complex number, and consider this function here. This is a holomorphic meromorphic function. Meromorphic function having poles at all integers, because the sinus of pi z has pole at every integer, having a pole at omega and another pole at minus omega. The residues at those poles are the residues of the function f at an integer, and you can compute all poles. These poles are simple. These poles are simple, so it is quite easy to compute residues. In this case, the residue is going to be the number 1 over pi times 1 over n squared minus omega squared at a point n, and at a point minus, n being any integer, okay, in this case, either positive or negative. The residue of f of z at omega and at minus omega is going to be the same. And at minus omega is going to be the same, it's going to be the cotangent of pi omega divided by 2 omega. It's a simple computation, not very hard, but it's quite elementary to arrive to this conclusion. Okay, now you can take as gamma n certain path, a square path, like this. certain path like this, which, as we have done before, which avoids, let's say, the integers. So, well, a path where the vertices are the points n plus 1/2, something like this. N plus 1/2, n plus 1/2. It avoids the integers. So this path, call it gamma n, this square path. And let us consider the integral of the function f along this path. Integral of the function f along this path. Using residue theorem, this integral, well, assume that you have taken n big enough such that omega and minus omega are inside the path. Okay, you have here omega and minus omega. So they are inside the path for some n big enough. Okay, so this is 2 pi I times the sum, of the residues inside of the poles that are inside the path. So they are sum of 1 over pi, 1 over, let's say, k square minus omega square from k equal 1 to n plus cotangent of pi omega to omega 2 times, because we have these two poles here, 2 times. Okay, this integral using residue theorem is going to be this number. Now, as usual, take n tend to infinity. Take n tend to infinity and, well, it's not a hard computation, but it's not so elementary. If you can bound, it's not very complicated to bound the integrand over this the sides of the triangle. So you need to take some care about the cotangent, etc. But it's not so complicated because of the election of the terms here, n plus 1 over 2. So this is the cotangent is going to be some fixed number, and it's not so difficult, in fact, to bound that. And you can, of course, the length of this side is elementary to compute, is 2n plus 1, more or less, the length of one of this side. So you can see easily that this integral must tend to zero. So you bound this f, this is bound by the, let's say, the integral is bound by the bound of f times the length of the square. You obtain some number where some n on the denominator that is clearly seen to be to tend to zero. So this integral tends to zero. So if this integral tends to zero, this sum here converges to zero. If this sum here converges to zero, you arrive to the following formula. You arrive to the formula that cotangent of pi omega over omega must be equal to minus 1 over pi times omega. I need to write, I repeat the n, I replace k by n here, n equal to 1 to infinity. You get to this formula here. Okay, in this case. Remember that we want to find some formula for the cotangent there, okay? For the cotangent there. So we could do the following in this formula. We could take, for instance, take some omega equal to z over pi, I think. Okay, to arrive to that formula. Yes, z over pi. Let's say this formula applies, in fact, for every omega non-integer. So, in fact, it's a developing for any non-integer omega. So, it's a developing of the function cotangent of pi omega. So, if you take some omega z over pi, you obtain here that the cotangent of z divided by z over pi, something like this, must be equal to minus 1 over pi, z over pi. It is correct. Yes, I hope not to make mistakes with the formulas, because z Okay, so this must be minus 1 over pi times the sum of pi square, z square minus n square pi square. Okay. And there is a 2 that must appear somewhere, and I don't find it now. I suppose there is, I don't know if there is a mistake somewhere. I think this is correct. Okay, we will see. There is a, I think there is a 2 that must appear somewhere that I don't find right now. Okay, anyway, we are up to this formula. Okay, well, pi. There is a minus also that I... yes, I already changed the order in the denominator, so this minus... Sorry, I think... is this correct or not? No, this is the minus, it must be here. Sorry, one moment. I don't want to make too many mistakes. No, this minus is removed. I have already had changed the order on the denominator here, okay? So this minus must be removed. Okay, yes. Pi goes with this pi here. And what we have besides, there is something, okay. There is something, there is a mistake in the formulas here. Yes, this is for every n. So there is something missing here. There is a 2 missing here, in fact. Because, okay, this is for positive and negative. This is positive and negative. So there was a 2 missing there. Okay, these 2 missing there must be here and must be here. Okay, and now multiply by pi. If you multiply by pi z, all this formula, you arrive to the expression cotangent of z equal to, multiplying by pi z, sum of multiply by z and divide by pi. Sorry. Multiply by z and divide by pi. So, okay, it was correct. You're right, this is, in fact, this would be n equal to 1 to infinity. This is also a mistake here. Okay, well, I forgot to write the term corresponding to n equal to 0. N equal to 0, yes. The terms with n different from 0 are doubled, both positive and negative, but there is also the term plus. The term corresponding to 0 here would be 1 over pi, 1 over... W square. So this term here would be 1 over pi. This is another term, something like this, z. And we multiply, when we have multiplied by this pi, goes with this pi, we arrive, finally, we must arrive, if our computations are well done, we must arrive to this formula here. Perhaps there is some, in the middle there must be something missing, but at the end the result is correct. We arrive to this formula and compare with the formula with the previous formula here. And compare with this formula we have here. Okay, so this term, we have this term here, the 1 over z we have there, so h prime must be 0 in the expression of the cotangent. H prime must be 0. In fact, this formula is quite useful to, in formula to, let's say, to develop the cotangent. It can be used in several contexts. But here we have that H prime must be 0, so H is a constant. If H is a constant, which is the expression we have now for the function sinus of z? We know that sinus of z over z sinus of z over z would be a constant here, e to the some constant, in fact. Okay, now how can we figure out which is the value of this constant? Take a value, for instance, take the value when z equals to zero. When z equals to zero, sinus of z over z tends to one, so at the term on the left is one, here is one, so e to the c must be one. And finally, we arrived to the formula that sinus of z is equal to z times the product of one which is miraculously the same formula to which Euler arrived without all these considerations. In fact, he was lucky enough in some sense because, well, he also he only assumed that for any entire function, the same argument as a polynomial could be applied, so it could be developed as a product of one minus something. And it is not true for every, of course, for every entire function. That, yes, it is true for the sinus because of the zeros of the sinus are regularly distributed in some sense, the zeros of the sinus. And he also had some luck because the zeros of the sinus are symmetric. So we cannot take the zeroth Weierstrass elementary factor here. In fact, it would be what Euler did, but we need to take the first Weierstrass elementary factor. But as the zeros are symmetric, the exponentials appearing in the Weierstrass elementary factors cancel. So finally, they cancel here. So finally, we have this product here. It would be the same product as if we had assumed from the beginning that we don't have these factors. That it was what Euler assumed. So he was lucky enough. Yes, that's true. But well, the ideas he had the correct ideas, while it didn't have the let's say all the arguments to show that his ideas were correct. Okay. Anyway, we arrive to this formula. This developing for the sinus. Okay. So let us continue, and the next step would be we have managed to construct functions with prescribed zeros on all the complex plane. Now we're going to do the same, but not with the whole complex plane, but with an open set. As if you have an open set and you want to construct a function with prescribed zeros on some open set. So consider U an open set on the Riemann sphere. U an open set on the Riemann sphere. And assume you have a sequence Zn of points without accumulation points on U. No accumulation points on U. And assume we have some sequence Mn of natural numbers. So we're going to construct a function F holomorphic on U having exactly these points Zn as zeros with these multiplicities, with prescribed multiplicities. Okay? Well, there is a case that we can avoid, the case U equal to C bar. This is almost trivial, let's say, in some sense, because, well, trivial, not exactly trivial, but this is a compact, so if the set of zeros has no accumulation points, it's a finite set. So we could take some polynomial, something like this, it's enough in that case. Okay? We must impose that at some point you have the value infinity. So you could take, for instance, a polynomial, and you know that at infinity it has the value infinity, but it cannot, you cannot avoid that. So we will assume that u is not z. Not z bar. Okay? If u is not z bar, doing perhaps some Möbius transformation, let's say moving a little bit everything, we are going to assume, well, the set of candidates to zero, we are going to call it A. We are going to assume that the point at infinity is in U, the point at infinity is in U, and moreover, that the point at infinity is not in A. We can assume that without pain. Okay? The point at infinity is in U and not in A. Okay? So, we have our set U here and our sequence. Our sequence. Okay? Of course, we can assume that the sequence is, in fact, infinite. If it is a finite sequence, everything is almost trivial in some sense. Okay, for every point Zn here, take the closest point, it's not, I think in this drawing is not the closest one, perhaps it's here, the closest point on the boundary. So let, for every Zn, take Zn not in U, so it would be in the boundary, such that the distance from Zn minus omega n is equal to the distance from Zn to the complement of U. The complement is a closed set, the distance is strictly positive, and you take this point. This number is, let's call this number Dn, is strictly positive. Okay? It is not hard to show that the limit of the Dn is zero. If not, you could find easily a sequence, a subsequence of the Zn accumulating in U, inside U. It's not so difficult to find that. So this goes to zero. So in fact, some sequence, perhaps like this. Okay, this is quite a simple drawing, but the distance to the distance of the sequence, the point of the sequence to the complement must be something that tends to zero. Okay, and let us consider the following. Take some epsilon. No, define some fz as follows. Define the function fs as fz as follows. Take the product when n is equal to infinity of en of zn minus omega n divided by z minus omega n. Consider this product, this infinite product. Let us see what happens with this infinite product. Consider a compact set contained in U. For a compact set contained in U, take R, the distance to the complement. This is strictly positive, of course, as K is compact and the complement is a closed set. So this is strictly positive. In this case, as this sequence tends to zero, assume that from some n, zero and beyond, these distances, Zn minus omega n, are smaller than R over 2, for instance. R over 2. Okay, so we have our set U. You have a compact set inside U here, and assume from some point beyond, all our points are more or less here. Okay, so what we have here inside the elementary factor, this term Zn minus omega n, I'm sorry, Zn minus omega n divided by Z minus omega n, this is more or equal than Zn minus omega n is smaller than R over 2, and Z minus omega n is greater or equal than R, because Z is a point on K and omega n is a point not on U. So this is more greater or equal than R. So let's put it here. So this term from n greater than some n0, what is inside the Weierstrass elementary factor, is smaller than 1 over 2. 1 over 2. Okay, so 1 minus this is smaller than 1 over 2 to the power n plus 1 on K. And this is of course a geometrical series, a convergent geometrical series. So this product here converges. We could divide, so in the compact K, you could divide this product here as two parts. First of all, the product n and to n0 of E Zn minus omega n Z minus omega n, and times the rest of the terms. So we have shown that this product here converges uniformly on the compact set K. Converges uniformly, and the factors are not zero. So this product here converges uniformly on compact set K to a function which has not zeros on K. So the only zeros of this expression on K can be here, on the factors here. And the factor here, the only possibility it is zero is that Z equal to Zn. So this expression here only has zeros on the compact set K, only has zeros in the points Zn, provided the points Zn is in the compact set K. Okay, so finally this expression defines a holomorphic function by all the results defined on the set U and having these prescribed zeros. How can we I forgot to say a word about the multiplicities of the zeros. Well, if the zero has multiplicity mn, you only need to take the point Zn mn times. You take the point Zn mn times, so there are mn equal factors here, and the result is proven. Okay, so you can find a function with having zeros in the points that you want, exactly the points you want. This could be used, for instance, as a application to construct functions that cannot be this could be used. One problem I will apply, but I need to say some things. To find some function that cannot be extended, if you take an open set U, a function that cannot be extended to any point beyond this set U. But we need still to prove some things about that. Okay? And before arriving to this result. Okay. And using that, using a similar result we are going to prove now, is what is called Mittag-Leffler's theorem. Mittag-Leffler's theorem that says the following. Thank you. Again, take any sequence of points Zn tending to infinity, in this case. Zn, take any sequence. Assume that any of the points is zero, for instance. Assume that no point is zero in this sequence, okay? The objective of this theorem is to construct a function, a meromorphic function on C, having this point Zn as prescribed poles. Poles. With, we know that if we have a pole, a function has a pole at a point A, around that point, an expansion can be found as in the following, have the following expression. First of all, we have some finite quantity, finite amount of terms with negative exponents, so some a n z n from n equal to 1 to some n, let's say some m here, m would be the order of the pole, and after that we have the rest, let's say the terms with exponents of positive order. This part is going to be called the principal part. Well, if it's a point A, sorry, it would be in power of Z minus A. The power would be Z minus A. Okay? So this term, this part here is going to be called the principal part. And it's a polynomial. You can observe that it's a polynomial. Qn in 1 minus z minus a. Take a polynomial and you replace z by 1 over z minus a. Okay, so consider this sequence of numbers tending to infinity. For each of the sequence, take a polynomial as you want, a prescribed polynomial. Take some qn of 1 minus z over Zn. So take any some polynomial Qn, evaluate in the point in the term 1 over Z minus Zn, and consider that. And the objective is to find a meromorphic function having this expression there as principal parts in each of the poles. So there always exists, there exists. If a meromorphic function on C, denote like this, having the poles, the points Zn as poles, having Zn as poles, with prescribed linear parts. Principal part, sorry. Principal parts. Okay? You can always construct a function like this. Meromorphic function having poles with prescribed principal parts. What is the idea of this construction? What is the idea of this construction? Okay. So, take... The idea is the following. Imagine the number of possible candidate to poles were finite. Imagine you only have a finite number. Okay, if you have a finite number of points, you could consider these polynomials, let's say here, and to take the sum of all these polynomials, of a finite number of polynomials, so you would have your function, and you are finished. Now, you cannot do that. Why? Because this sum of all these terms does not converge necessarily. So you have to arrange a little bit this sum. You have to modify a little bit this sum. So to each of the terms here, you have to, let's say, to remove some part, some big part of this term, in order to have something that converges. So what is the idea? Take this Qn of 1 z minus Zn. This is a polynomial applied to this to this quotient, 1 over z minus zn. So, in fact, this is a holomorphic function. This represents the holomorphic in the disk center at the origin with radius zn. Modulo of zn. We are assuming that zn is different from 0. Okay? If our point zn is here, this expression defines some holomorphic function here. So, as a holomorphic function here, it can be written, okay, it can be written as, well, can be written as a power series expansion. So, something acts ANK ZK. Something like this. Having, this is a series having as radius of convergence Zn is the radius of convergence of this series. Take now, for instance, take the number 1 over 2 and consider the closed disk for instance this closed disk. This series here converges uniformly in compact sets of the this open disk. In particular, it converges uniformly in this open disk. Okay, so we can find a finite number of terms of this series, some Pn of z, finite number of terms of this series, some terms nk, zk, from k equal 0 to some number, let's call it mu n, such that this expression here, call it this expression qn, qn of z, briefly, this expression, such that Qn of z minus Pn of z, okay, this Qn of z minus Pn of z is smaller than 1 over 2 to the n on this disk. Call the n bar this disk on the n bar by uniform convergence. Okay. Now, take a compact set. Take a compact set contained on C. If you have a compact set contained on C, this is contained, of course, in a ball, in a disk of certain radius R, big R. So you can take n big enough, greater than n0, such that zn, for instance, is greater than 2r. Okay? You could take in this way. So you can separate, you are going to, the function you are going to construct is going to be this function here. This function here. Okay, we're going to see that this series converges. So it is what we have as Qn there, but we have removed some small, some bigger, big terms. We have only left the, let's say, a small part in order to guarantee convergence. And so we're going to show that this series here converges. So if you take this K contained in C, you take N0 like this, you can separate this series as n0 minus 1, and let us observe that this term is holomorphic in fact in the compact set K because well, there is some poles in the terms Qn, but the pole of Qn is in the point Zn, and in the terms here, Zn is big enough, is greater than 2r. So all the terms in this sum are holomorphic over the compact set K over the disk of radius big R. And on this disk of radius big R, on K also, this expression here can be bounded by 1 over 2 to the n because of the election of the polynomials Pn there. Okay, and it converges, of course. So this converges uniformly on the disk of radius big R. So it defines a holomorphic function on this disk. This disk, and this is a finite sum. So this expression defines a function on the disk of radius big R. This part is holomorphic, so the only in this disk, the only possible poles would come from this part here. So the only possible poles would come from the terms here, such that they have poles on the disk. So from the terms Qn having been Zn in this disk. And by the construction, the principal part of each of the poles is the prescribed term we have there. Okay? So, as R, big R, is have been chosen as any, can be taken as any value, so this expression, in fact, converges uniformly in compacts and defines a meromorphic function having poles, having prescribed poles. Okay. One last comment: this restriction is not important, of course, because it's only one point. So if we want to have a function having also a pole at zero, and we have a prescribed principal part at zero, this prescribed principal part is a polynomial. Okay. So finally, at the end, we add this polynomial. This is a polynomial in 1/z. We add this polynomial at the end, and we are done. And we have the wanted expression. So the results are quite curious because of the following fact. As we have seen in many theorems, holomorphic functions are quite rigid. I mean, there are very simple conditions that if they are not warranted, the function is constant. For instance, you have an accumulation point, the function is constant. An injective sequence of injective functions. If it is not injective, the limit it is constant. A limit of function that has no zeros. If the limit has one zero, it is identically zero. So these are quite rigid. But in fact, the results are quite general. So yes, you cannot assume that your let's say your poles. Have an accumulation point, but if you don't assume that they don't have an accumulation point, you can have whatever you want. You can have holomorphic function having the set as you want, a set of poles, and you can have any prescribed set of principal parts. So in some sense this is too general, simply assuming that those restrictions we have stated are not verified here. But if they are not like this, every function can be constructed. And so for that, this is quite the opposite of the results, the restriction results we have already found on holomorphic functions. Okay, so I think I finish here.